Got another question for the Alkanes and Hello Alkanes playlist, and as always, the link to the questions in the description of the video if you want to try it first. Okay, so we'll make a start. So the first thing we'll do is explain what's meant by the term structural isomer, and then obviously link it to these three hydrocarbons. So definition of a structural isomer: molecules with the same molecular formula, but they have different structural formula. Why are these all structural isomers? Because they've all got the molecular formula C5H12. Obviously, the structural formula is different. So we'll move on to the second bullet point now. Explain the trend in the boiling point shown by A, B, and C in the table. Well, you can see that this is the unbranched one. It's got the highest boiling point. The most branched one has got the lowest boiling point. So a nice simple trend there: the greater the degree of branching, the lower the boiling point. So there's that bit there, and all we need to do now is link it to intermolecular force strength and therefore the energy needed to overcome. So I've gone for A, the highest boiling point one, with no branches. So I'm saying A has no branches, so its molecules have the most surface contact and therefore the strongest London forces. Therefore, the most amount of energy is needed to break the intermolecular forces. Alternatively, you could give the other extreme. So molecule C has got the most branching, it's got the least amount of surface contact, the weakest London forces, therefore the least amount of energy needed to break the intermolecular forces. Moving on to part B. So what's the name of the mechanism for the reaction between an alkane and chlorine in the presence of UV? Radical substitution. Next part, what's the number of structural isomers possible for the monosubstitution? That's with one chlorine in. So we could have chlorine here, here, or here. So remember, there and there's the same, there and there's the same. So it's three for A. Molecule B, you could put the chlorine there, which is equivalent to there. So one there, so two, three, four. And the next part, compound D's obviously still got its five carbons. So if we take 60 from the 175.5, that gives us 115.5. So to find out how many chlorines are in there, if we divide that by 35.5, we get just over 3, so there must be 3 chlorines in the molecule. So that means the molecular formula for D is going to be C5Cl3H9. Now there's loads of possible structures for this, so I'll just give you a few. You could have that one there, that one there, that one there, and the last one I'm going to show you, because there's so many, that one there. So moving on to the equation, so there it is there, and the thing to remember about this equation or this reaction is for each substitution, so we've got three substitutions here, you need a mole of halogen, so we needed 3 moles of Cl2, and you make 3 moles of HCl in this case, hydrogen halide. So for each substitution, you need a mole of halogen, and you make a mole of hydrogen halide. Moving on to the next question about hydrolysis of haloalkanes. So we'll state and explain how the halogen in the haloalkane affects the rate of hydrolysis. Remember, the rate of hydrolysis is all linked to the bond enthalpy of the carbon-halogen bond. So the lower the bond enthalpy of the carbon-halogen bond, the faster the reaction. So the trend in the halogens, the CF bond is the strongest, so that's hydrolyzed the slowest. And the one at the bottom, Ci, is the weakest, and therefore hydrolyzed the fastest. Moving on to the mechanism, so chlorocyclohexane is hydrolyzed with aqueous sodium hydroxide, so it's attacked by hydroxide ions. You can have the minus sign above the O like I've got there, or you could have it here. Need a dipole on this carbon-halogen bond, so delta plus on the carbon, delta minus on the chlorine. And we take a curly arrow from the lone pair on the O and take it to that slightly positive carbon. And that's going to break this bond by heterolytic fission. So we show that with a curly arrow from the middle of the bond onto the chlorine. So the organic product's going to be that, that's cyclohexanol. But don't forget about the Cl minus ion that's produced as well. Moving on to part C now. So we've got to draw this label diagram to show how the student would carry out this hydrolysis. And we're told that it is refluxed, so it wants reflux apparatus. So let's just label this up. So we've got a flask here, I've drawn a round bottom flask. You could have a pear-shaped flask there if you want. Let's put the chemicals in. Obviously, we've got the heat source at the bottom. This thing here is your condenser. And the only other thing to remember is the direction of the water through the condenser. It goes in at the bottom and it comes out at the top. And the other couple of things to mention is make sure you don't have anything in the top, so no bung or anything at the top of your condenser, and just make sure you don't have any gaps here so there's no vapors can escape that way. Moving on to the last part of the question now. So I've come up with a sort of generic equation for what's happened. So we've got our haloalkane E, it's been hydrolyzed and we've formed alcohol F and halide ion. And we were told that we had 0.01 moles of the haloalkane. So because of the mole ratio 1 to 1 to 1, we're going to get 0.01 moles of F and 0.01 moles of X minus a halide ion. So then if you think about the silver nitrate, is going to react, the silver ions are going to react with these halide ions and make a precipitate. So that means we're going to make 0.01 moles of the precipitate. Remember, that's G. Now, because we know the mass of this, we can work out its MR. So mass over moles gives 188. So if we subtract the MR of silver now, so that leaves 80.1 for the halide. Well, bromine's 79.9, so it's going to be a bromide, a silver bromide precipitate. So if we deal with F next, remember this is the alcohol that's formed, where we were told the MR of this was 74. Subtract the MR of the OH group, which is 17, that leaves us with 57 for the MR of the carbons and hydrogens. That means the R group is C4H9. Now, the other bit of information we're told about F is that it has a chiral centre. So it can't be butane-1-ol because that doesn't have a chiral centre. So it means it must be butane-2-ol, which does have a chiral centre. So this carbon here is bonded to four different things, so methyl, ethyl, hydrogen, and the hydroxyl group. So moving on to E now, we've already established that this X, this halide, is bromine. E is going to be 2-bromobutane.